I'm Dr. Mukul Mohindra, your orthopedic instructor here at An Academy, and I'm here in front of you to cover up the upper limb fracture eponyms. Okay, and why this kind of a topic? Because I think you know well that your dates for NEET PG 2021 have been declared. So 18th April is the destiny day. So I thought, why not have a quick revision of all the upper limb fractures in a smart manner? So that was one of the purpose, you know, I specifically chose up this particular topic. So let me begin the discussion quickly. Okay, so this is an image just copied from the NEET PG exam last year. This image was there in the exam. You could see a drop of the finger at this distal interphalangeal joint, and you were supposed to mark the diagnosis. This was the answer, mallet finger. Almost everyone could pick it up. Very, very easy and a simple question. And mallet finger is nothing else. It tends to be rupture of this tendon, extensor digitorum communis. And this rupture generally occurs at the base of distal phalanx. So that's perhaps, you know, what you call as the mallet finger. The counterpart of mallet finger tends to be jersey finger. And here you find rupture of the flexor tendon, to be specific, flexor digitorum profundus. Mind you, this question was there in the AIIMS paper last year. So both mallet and jersey finger have been there in the exams, alright. But yeah, this particular deformity I've shown you is mallet finger. This particular deformity. Okay, so you have rupture of extensor tendon, you call it mallet finger. You have rupture of the flexor tendon, we call it jersey finger. I must also clear to you as to what is meant by a Kaplan injury. Here you basically have dislocation of metacarpophalangeal joint. Specifically speaking, this term refers to dislocation of MCP joint at the index finger. But yes, you can also extrapolate it to be used at other fingers. So to be specific, MCP joint means the knuckles. So I hope you guys are clear with all these three terms. Dislocation at the knuckles, Kaplan injury. Rupture of the flexor tendon, jersey finger. Rupture of the extensor tendon, mallet finger. Yes, a word about another very important injury in the area of the hand. Gamekeeper's thumb, skier's thumb. Okay, now please understand. If you look at this metacarpophalangeal joint of the thumb, on the two sides, you have collateral ligaments. Medially, you have the ulnar collateral ligament. Laterally, you have the radial collateral ligament. So this is the ulnar collateral ligament marked for you here. So you can see it has avulsed from this proximal phalanx. So that's what you call as gamekeeper's thumb or skier's thumb. Why skier's thumb? Because people who are involved in the sport of skiing, when they meet with this accident, this thumb is pulled like this, and this ulnar collateral ligament often avulses. You can note down even this definition. What is gamekeeper's thumb or skier's thumb? It is rupture of ulnar collateral ligament at the level of metacarpophalangeal joint of thumb. And I hope you have seen this picture nicely. The ulnar collateral ligament is avulsing from the proximal phalanx. I am sure you can see it over here also. This avulsion from the proximal phalanx. So I hope you'll be able even to pick it up here. The diagnosis. Gamekeeper's thumb, skier's thumb. Fine enough, guys? I suppose no confusion. Clear with the X-ray image. You'll be able to pick it up from the X-ray. Perfect enough. Perfect enough. Alright. Now moving a little further, what about bowler's thumb also? People often tend to think that bowler's thumb refers to people who are involved with that sport of cricket, because that is what generally ball means to us. But mind you, I am talking of that other game, bowling, where you have to, you know, use this kind of a ball, put your thumb in between that hole. So what happens in bowler's thumb? It's not an injury, it's basically a neuroma rather than a frank injury. And this neuroma tends to involve common distal nerve of thumb. It's basically due to the repeated friction. So when you have a neuroma of the common distal nerve of thumb, that is what you label as bowler's thumb. So this is not a fracture. I've just put it over here so that you are clear about this terminology also, and you don't relate it to that cricketing stuff. Okay, people with spin bowling, fast bowling, nothing of that sort. It's absolutely a different thing, bowler's thumb. Now, a very, very, very important question. This term, Bennett's fracture. Now, I've just picked up this question from one of the old FMG exam, and was also there in the NEET PG exam a little time back. Bennett's fracture. Now, before I take you through the answer over here, let me first take you through two important fractures. There is something called a Bennett fracture, and there is something called a Rolando fracture. They're very closely related to each other. Now, both of these fractures, they tend to involve a base of first metacarpal. What I mean by first metacarpal, this particular area, metacarpal of the thumb. Okay. And they are both intra-articular fractures at the base of first metacarpal, as I told you, which is the thumb metacarpal. So they are basically fractures of this particular area involving the trapezio metacarpal joint, fracture dislocation of the trapezio metacarpal joint. This is the area that this fracture is involving, and this is the same area, you know, that's involved by either Bennett or Rolando fracture. So they're basically fracture dislocations around the trapezio metacarpal joint, because they're intra-articular fractures. So you can use the term fracture dislocation. Now, often an examiner at times wants to know from you, what is the difference between the two fractures? So let me tell you, it is the shape. See, oblique pattern fracture, Bennett. But see, Y. A Y has been formed. So when you find a Y pattern fracture, it's Rolando. So that's actually the simple but a very basic difference. You find an oblique fracture at the base of the first metacarpal, that is intra-articular, you call it Bennett. You find a Y-shaped fracture at the base of the first metacarpal, you call it Rolando. So I hope you guys are clear with this terminology. And mind you, the X-ray I used to show you this fracture, to let you understand the anatomy, also has another fracture that is visible. I have marked it with this white arrow. I hope you can see the neck of the fifth metacarpal broken. So guys, do I need to tell you what is this particular fracture that's involving the neck of the fifth metacarpal? Do I need to tell you? You punch, you hit this neck of the fifth metacarpal straight somewhere, the neck of the fifth metacarpal breaks. So this particular injury will be Boxer's fracture. Okay. So Boxer's fracture is technically speaking a fracture of neck of fifth metacarpal. A fracture of the neck of the fifth metacarpal is what you call as the Boxer's fracture. So I hope you guys are clear, absolutely crystal clear with this terminology in the hand. Now, moving a little further from the hand, let me go a little proximal and also take you through the distal end radius fractures, fractures around the distal end of the radius. Now, it's very, very common, you know, now the pattern of exam that you have, especially the INICT type pattern, the AIMS NEET PG type pattern also, that sometimes you tend to get these questions, match the following, extended match the following, okay, and you might have to match the images, some clinical histories at times, or sometimes, you know, they can also come up as one-liner that identify the fracture. So all patterns are possible. Now, these fractures at the distal end of the radius often tend to overlap a little bit, and you can be, you know, really confused at times. So let me show you all these four fracture patterns, what they actually mean, and then we come back to this question and answer. All right, now see here. First, this particular image. I hope you can see this fracture. And it's at a very classical area. This is the metafascial fragment. This is the diaphyseal fragment. So you have a fracture at the junction of metaphyses with the diaphyses. And I hope you can see this distal fragment. It has gone posteriorly, dorsally. So this particular fracture is called Coley's fracture. And what you find in Coley's fracture? Fracture at metaphyseal-diaphyseal junction with dorsal displacement, as I just showed you, of distal fragment. So the distal fragment basically goes posteriorly or dorsally, as I've just shown you in this particular x-ray. Now see this particular image, this one. So here also you will find a fracture at the junction of metaphyses with the diaphyses. So this is also a metaphyseal-diaphyseal junction fracture. But what you can see, this distal fragment has gone in front, anteriorly. So now this displacement is reverse of the dorsal displacement you saw in Coley's fracture. So this is a reverse Coley's fracture. That's also called as Smith's fracture. So that you need to remember for Smith's fracture. Nothing much, but simply that it's a reverse Coley's fracture. Smith's fracture. So I hope you are absolutely clear as to what is Coley's fracture, what is Smith's fracture. And I hope you're absolutely clear with the fact that both of these, they are extra-articular fractures. They're not involving the joint. The joint is not involved. That is very, very important. Because, you know, when you find the joint involvement in this area, like see this particular x-ray. I hope you can see fracture entering into the wrist joint here. See, fracture violating the joint here. So the joint has been violated. And this whole wrist is subluxating in front. So here what you have is basically an intra-articular fracture at distal end of radius. And this particular diagnosis is what you call as Barton's fracture, this x-ray. So the moment you find the joint involved, you label it as Barton's fracture. And it's actually not a fracture, it's a Barton's fracture dislocation, because the whole wrist also subluxates. So that is what is Barton's fracture. And I hope you can very well identify this particular image. There's a fracture of the styloid process of radius. The styloid process is fractured. So this is a diagnosis that is labeled as Schoffer's fracture. So these are some important fractures around the distal end of the radius. Okay, so once you know the diagnosis now, it becomes very, very easy even for you to match these answers. So this is it. First one is C. This is Schoffer. 4 is B. 4, this is Barton's. Okay. D is 3. If you go by this, D is 3. So 3, this is Smith. Okay. So almost everything is matching here in choice C. But it's all about, you know, knowing the anatomy in each fracture and then the terminology. Now see this particular fracture. Distal end of radius shattered. Normally radius is longer than ulna. Now the ulna has become longer than radius. So this particular fracture is called die punch fracture. Here you have a comminuted, impacted because fragments have, you know, jammed into each other. So there is shortening of the radius. So you have a comminuted impacted fracture at distal end of radius. That is what is called a die punch fracture. And this also tends to be the intra-articular variety. So these are some important fracture patterns that you find around the distal radius. Moving a little further. Now have a nice look at this x-ray. I'm sure you can very easily spot there's a fracture in the ulna. Now please understand the big problem. Fracture in the ulna, you often rush on to take it as a Montachia fracture. But mind you, this fracture also involves the ulna, and not many people know about it. Nightstick fracture is basically a fracture of shaft of ulna, and that is what you see over here in this particular x-ray, a fracture of the shaft of the ulna. But yes, how is it different from a Montegia fracture? I'll just show you. Now see this particular x-ray. I hope you can see the ulna broken, but just go a little proximally. See this radio ulnar joint dislocated. Mind you, see here, ulna broken, but nothing wrong with the radio ulnar joint. So night stick fracture. Ulna broken, radio ulnar joint dislocated, Montegia fracture. So that is the difference. So now you can write down the definition of Montegia fracture with me. Here you have fracture of proximal third ulna. So that area is very specific. And here you find dislocation of proximal radio ulnar joint. So this combination is called Montegia fracture. And the counterpart of Montegia is Glazy fracture. Here you have fracture of lower third radius. Okay. And along with it, you have dislocation of distal radio ulnar joint. I hope you can notice, this is the fracture of the lower third radius, and I hope you can notice in this area there is a dislocation of the radio ulnar joint. So guys, I hope you are absolutely clear with this terminology as to when to call it a night stick fracture, when to call it a Montegia fracture, and when to call it a Glazy fracture. Any confusions, guys? Any confusion? I'm looking at the chat box. If you have a confusion, please drop it so that I can clear your query. Here only. Alright. So I suppose things are clear to you if there's no query. Now see this particular x-ray. This is capitulum that articulates with the head of the radius. And this is trochlea that articulates with the olecranon process of ulna. So what you can see in this particular image is a fracture of trochlea. And mind you, don't get carried away by this question. The injury you find in a javelin thrower, please. In a person who throws the javelin, you tend to find fractures of the olecranon. And this fracture, hence, it's also called as javelin thrower's fracture. Clear? And rather, this fracture of trochlea that I've shown in this image, this is called as Loggier's fracture. So clear? Javelin thrower, olecranon. Fracture of trochlea, Loggier's fracture. And yes, then this term, Hotchkiss terrible triad at the elbow. Here you have three things. A fracture of radial head, generally comminuted type of fracture in the radial head, as you can see in this particular image. Second thing, fracture of coronoid process of ulna. And one last thing, posterior dislocation of the elbow. So when you find these three things, you label it as the Hotchkiss terrible triad at the elbow. So I think now you are clear with all the terminologies. You find the trochlea broken, that's Loggier's fracture. You find the olecranon broken, that's javelin thrower's fracture. And when you find the coronoid process broken, try looking at the radial head and the elbow joint. You find the radial head also broken, dislocation of the elbow also there. This kind of a scenario, you label it as Hotchkiss terrible triad. Very, very important MCQ. Very, very important MCQ, Hotchkiss terrible triad at the elbow. It's a very dangerous, very troublesome injury. Okay, guys? Alright. Now, this is one of my favorite, you know. It's a very, you know, smart kind of a question. You can only answer it if you have good understanding of this concept. Examiner has asked you something very, very simple. You already heard about it, but in a very smart manner. 26 years old female, she's come to you. Just after the accident, she's been brought to your emergency. You click the X-ray and you find this comminuted fracture in the radial head. Now, radial head is one of that area that is excised at times. So all of the following lines of management are appropriate, except. So what is not appropriate at this stage? Now, you will be surprised to see me answer excision of the fragments, because it is well known that radial head is one area where excision of the fragments is actually a treatment. So rest everything is appropriate at that stage, but not excision of the fragments. Strange. I will tell you what is the problem here. I'm sure you would have heard of something called SX low presti lesion, or if you've not heard, let me explain it to you in a very simple language. Now, sometimes patients come to you with fracture of radial head that has a comminuted type of fracture pattern, means shattered fracture, multiple fracture pieces. Okay. Now, we often tend to forget that fracture does not mean injury to the bone. Like if I have a fall, how is it possible that only my bone will break? Some soft tissues will also be injured. Because a fracture is, technically speaking, a soft tissue injury where the bone also breaks. So that is what I am trying to explain to you. That in every fracture there is soft tissue injury. So along with this comminuted fracture of the radial head, there is a hidden injury to interosseous membrane that we just undermine, that we just ignore. Now thinking that it is a comminuted fracture, we move ahead with the treatment, excision of radial head. And this is what happens next. The radius migrates proximally into the elbow joint. So you have removed the head, the interosseous membrane is already gone. So now the radius migrates, goes into the elbow joint, making the movement at the elbow joint impossible. This whole story is what you call as SX low presti lesion. So SX low presti lesion means radius migrated proximally into the elbow joint because you have excised a comminuted fracture of the radial head with the interosseous membrane still injured. So that is what is recommended for prevention, that if you are dealing with a comminuted fracture, never excise in less than 3 weeks. Mind you, never. At least wait for 3 weeks for interosseous membrane to heal up. Clear? An alternative is replace the head in acute cases. That is also allowed if the patient has the budget. So you can also replace the radial head to stop the proximal migration in case you wish to excise in acute cases. Otherwise, best is give 3 weeks, 4 weeks, let the interosseous membrane heal up. Now excise the radial head to prevent the SX low presti lesion. So I hope you are absolutely clear with it. So now you've got the message that this is an acute scenario. So you won't be excising the head. You can give a slab to pass some time. You can replace the head or even try to fix the fracture. But don't excise. You excise SX low presti lesion. Clear with the message? Now have a look at this particular picture. This picture was there in the NEET exam. And people were confused. They were especially confused between these two options. These options and this option. People who thought AIN is the answer, they had this diagnosis in mind. Fracture supracondylar humerus. And people who thought radial nerve is injured, they had this diagnosis in mind, fracture shaft of humerus. Now let me tell you, this is the answer here, radial nerve, because this fracture is involving the shaft of humerus. In fact, let me tell you, there is a fracture of shaft of humerus, strictly speaking, at junction of upper two-third with lower one third. And this particular fracture is popularly known as a Holstein-Lewis fracture. That is how you better call this fracture, Holstein-Lewis. A fracture at the junction of upper two-third and lower one-third of humerus. You can see upper two-third, lower one-third. Now this is a fracture notoriously known to complicate the radial nerve. So radial nerve palsy is almost like present in 90% of these cases. So that is how this is the answer. Because we are dealing with Holstein-Lewis fracture. But yes, why is it not the supracondylar humerus fracture where AIN, anterior interosseous nerve or median nerve, tends to be injured? I'll tell you. What is meant by this fracture supracondylar humerus? See this olecranon fossa. See this shadow. So when you find the fracture line passing through the olecranon fossa, then you label it as supracondylar humerus. So that is where the fracture line will be passing through the olecranon fossa. And mind you, if it is fracture supracondylar humerus, here you will find anterior interosseous nerve injury, and this is classically a fracture of children, especially less than 10 years of age. I think you already know about that, but I hope you'll be easily able to identify and differentiate the supracondylar from the Holstein-Lewis fracture pattern. And when I've spoken of fractures in children, I think I cannot refrain myself from telling you first this classical fracture pattern. In fact, you must be already knowing it, that this is what you call as a green stick fracture. And I think you understand what is there in a green stick. You find one cortex of bone broken. You note the other cortex of the bone tends to be intact. And radius is normally a straight bone. But I'm sure in this particular area, you can also note bending of bone. So when you find only one cortex broken, other cortex intact, and bending of the bone that is visible, this classical fracture pattern is called a green stick fracture, classically seen in children, because of their bones having little different properties from that of adults. And if you see this second fracture pattern, I'm sure you will find there is something wrong with this cortex of radius. And you can see this particular area here. I'm sure you will note that a cortex of radius has been pressed inside like this. So basically, there is buckling of single cortex. Buckling means depression in single cortex, you know, as you press a buckle in a bag. So this classical fracture pattern is called torus fracture. So one is a green stick fracture pattern you find in children. Second is the torus fracture pattern. So these are classical fracture patterns you find in children. So I hope you are clear with the word green stick, and I hope you are clear with the word torus fracture. And in the end, one last question. To wrap up, 4 years old boy, problem in the elbow. Look at the position. He is holding the elbow in pronation and extension. Mind you, x-ray is absolutely normal. So no bone injury. Nothing wrong with the bone. But something wrong with the elbow. So first you need to know the diagnosis so as to reach the treatment part. Alright. So I'll take you through this term called pulled elbow. Sometimes, you know, child is falling down, and the parent is holding the elbow, and the elbow tends to get pulled. So what happens in this particular scenario? You find subluxation of the radial head out of the annular ligament that surrounds the radial neck. So radial head basically subluxates, slips out of that annular ligament, you know. So you have an annular ligament surrounding the radial head, but head slips out of the annular ligament. That's what you call as pulled elbow. Now something very, very classical. Children less than 4 years tend to be involved. It does not occur after the age of 4 years. Because if you go through the ossification formula at the elbow, what you find after 4 years, that this radial head tends to undergo ossification. So after 4 years, head ossifies, so it does not slip outside the annular ligament easily. In this age group, the head is small, so it very easily slips by pulling the elbow. The classical clinical feature with which these children come to you, forearm is held in pronation. That is the classical clinical picture with which they come to you. And when this is the scenario, just supinate the forearm, the head reduces back. So that is the answer here. Supinate the forearm, the head will go back. But counsel the person, parent, that you know, don't pull the elbow much in first 4 years of life. The head is not ossified, it might dislocate it or subluxate. And guys, I must also tell you that this term pulled elbow is synonymous with this word called nurse maid's elbow. Synonymous. And this word is synonymous with another term that is called Malgegnie's subluxation. So you call it pulled elbow, you call it nurse maid's elbow, you call it Malgegnie's subluxation, synonymous. Same thing. You find the subluxation of the radial head out of the annular ligament. So that's all from my side. I'm done with it. I've taken you through all the important terminologies, the eponyms from the upper limb. You wish to attend more such classes? Go to this website, Unacademy. Open up the app, lot of free material even for you. And yes, in case you wish to stay connected with me, then just note down the Telegram group I run, t.me, Dr. Mukul Ortho. Telegram, you can join, connect to me by using the link. And then I'll keep you posted about my further sessions. Anything else, any query you have, I generally clear it in a very timely manner. So that's a good way to stay in touch with me. You can also mail me up, catch me up on Facebook as you feel like. So hope you enjoyed the class. We'll be back in a little while with some more important things for you. Bye-bye. Good night. Have a nice time.